Dear students, we are in the 22nd part of the hand complex, continuing in the extrinsic finger flexor muscles. So you understood the orientation of annular pulleys and the function of the annular pulleys, and the third annular pulley lies at the distalmost part of the proximal phalanx, this one, distalmost part, and then you have the A4, that is annular 4 pulley, which is in the middle phalanx. So this phalanx, and then we have another one which is in the distal phalanx, that is A5. Here it is not shown in this figure, so it will be present somewhere here. So fifth annular pulley, so five annular pulleys are, you know, anchoring the FDS and FTP tendons properly, so that they don't bowstring, and they help in gliding mechanism along with the tendon sheath which is present. They prevent friction and they anchor it properly so that efficient flexion action happens. So here in the next so again you can see the same figure I have given you here also. So you can see clearly the annular pulleys A1, A2, A3, A4 and A5. And in between you can see the cruciate ligament, the first C1, C2 and C3. So they are, cruciate are exactly between the annular. So between the five annular pulleys, how many gaps will be there? Three gaps. So in three gaps you have C1, C2, C3 cruciate pulleys in each finger. Every finger it is there. Here they have only one finger they have not shown, because so that we can see the camptus chiasma. So here also same way it is there. So three cruciate crisscrossing pulleys also tether the long flexor tendons. One is located between the A2 and A3 pulleys and designated C1. Next one is cruciate pulleys, A3, A4, A4, A5. So between the A1 and A2 we don't have, because the A1 we have the strong transverse metacarpal ligament which is attaching. So annular pulley also attaching to the transverse deep transverse metacarpal ligaments. So the cruciate ligament pulleys are present between the A2 and A3, A3 and A4, and A4 and A5. So the next cruciate, that is the C2, lies between the A3 and A4. Last cruciate pulley, C3, lies between the A4 and A5. The A4 and A5 and the C3 structures contain only the FDP. You all know that. So from here the FDS finishes here. So after that the last cruciate and the two annular pulleys and the last cruciate pulleys, that is A4, A5 and C3, the only tendon passing or anchoring only one tendon. Which tendon is that? FTP, because the FTS muscle inserts in the middle phalanx. The annular pulleys and the cruciate ligaments vary among individuals in both number and extent. We cannot say that all people or everyone will have exactly same number of cruciate ligaments and annular pulleys. Some people may not have some cruciate ligaments or some annular pulleys, so that we cannot count that as abnormality. So this is common. And here if you see the thumb only have two annular pulley and one oblique pulley. See, this is parallel, no? So this is annular 1, annular 2, this is a oblique ligament, that is oblique pulley. So we don't have a cruciate pulley here in the thumb. We have two annular pulleys and one oblique pulley. So what are the functions and what is how is nutrition circulation is happening? So that is what we'll discuss now. Friction of the FDS and FTP tendons on the annular pulleys and cruciate ligament is minimized by the digital tendon sheaths that envelop the tendon from point to which the tendons pass into the most proximal annular pulley, that is the A1 pulley, to the point at which the tendon of the FDP muscle passes through the most distal cruciate pulley, that is A5 pulley, and before that C3 pulley. So that is last cruciate pulley. So see, wherever the annular pulleys and cruciate pulleys are there, there naturally there is going to be a friction between the tendon and the ligaments. So in order to avoid that, we have a tendon which is covered by what we called as digital tendon sheaths. So this sheaths contains synovial like fluid contained in each of the digital tendon sheaths allows gliding of the tendons beneath their ligamentous constraints and between each other. So between each other tendons and between the ligament is constrained to in order to avoid any kind of friction to happen and to permit proper gliding mechanism, what we have is a synovial like fluid contained digital tendon sheets. So that is the main purpose of the digital sheets. Now the vascular supply to the gliding mechanism is critical. So vascular supply to the gliding, the whole gliding mechanism, for that properly vascularization is important to maintain the synovial fluid and as well as the cellular nutrition, tendon nutrition. So both thing, vascularization is very very important also for maintaining the synovial like fluid, for good gliding mechanism to prevent friction, and also for nutrition. So what are the, which is the vascularization? So vincular tendinum, don't forget that very important point, vincular tendinum. Direct vascularization of each tendon occurs through vessels that reach the tendon via the vincular tendinum. So normally the blood vessels, when they reach here to in order to reach to each tendon, the vascularization is ending in a structure called as vincular tendinum. So direct vascularization for each tendon, otherwise you will see vascularization coming to a particular muscle in a particular area, but here because this tendon requires too much of synovial like fluid and proper nutrition, because too much work is done, always we are moving our hand, all the time we are moving our hand, somehow we are moving it. So in order to prevent any kind of nutritional deficit or any kind of lack of synovial like fluid, so proper vascularization is given by direct vascularization by a structure called as vascular structure called as vincular tendinum. So vincular tendinum, the function of the annular pulleys is to keep the flexor tendons close to the bone. So the what is the function of annular pulley? To keep the flexor tendon close to the bone, so that allowing only a minimum amount of bowstringing action cannot be allowed. So that is the main purpose of annular pulley. They are anchoring it, allowing minimum amount of bowstringing migration volarly from joint axis. So joint moving away from the joint axis is not good again. So these two functions are done by annular pulleys. So now coming to the pathomechanics of the extrinsic finger flexors. So today we are finishing the finger flexor. Next class we'll have extrinsic finger extensors mechanism. So now you can see in this picture, you can clearly see that the tendons are coming under the flexor retinacula and they are going to each finger. The FDP and FDS is coming, and then you have the annular pulley. But when you see here, thickening of the tunnel, the annular pulley, that pulley system becomes thickened. So now what will happen? Thickened pulley means there is a nodule formation in the tendon also. So once the nodule comes down, means then it cannot go forward to the so the gliding mechanism will be affected. This kind of structure is called as problem is called as trigger finger. Trigger finger is an important point. This is an important point, you have to underline it. Any interruption in either the annular pulleys or the digital tendon sheets, both can happen. Either problem in the annular pulleys, first, this is the first annular pulley, or in the digital tendon sheets. So vascularization problem, inflammation of the digital tendon, nodule formation of the tendon, or thickening of the tunnel, that is the annular pulley, and which will not allow the gliding mechanism. So impairment of what will happen, both the FDS and FDP muscle, the functioning, either functioning or structural deformity may happen, both can happen. Trigger, this is called as trigger finger, is in one example of the disability, or is one example of the disability created when the repetitive trauma to flexor tendon results in the formation of nodules of the tendon, and what will happen? And the thickening of an annular pulley. So finger flexion may be prevented completely, or the finger may be unable to re-extend. Either you cannot flex the finger because the tunnel will not allow the gliding of the contraction of the tendon. So that means that either the trigger finger can show in two way. Either the patient may come and tell you that I cannot flex one finger, particularly one finger I cannot flex. Or once you flex vigorously, now after flexion you cannot extend. Why? Because the flexor tendon is stuck, after the nodule passes the annular pulley, now again it has to pass through the annular pulley again forward, it won't go. So either the flexion is prevented completely or the fingers cannot re-extend again. Thank you, dear students. Study the three parts I have given posted you today, and submit an assignment on the extrinsic finger flexor, biomechanics of extrinsic finger flexors, with all the figures which I have given. Thank you.